Comrades, we have finally reached the end of our journey. We've suffered a lot together watching these two idiotic imbeciles ruin each other's lives in pretty much every way humanly possible. Because Carrie and Big don't believe in couples counseling, or at least individual therapy.
To be honest, I just don't buy the whole shrink thing. Therapy, it's just so self-indulgent.
Choosing instead to trauma bond via their incompatibility, we have been brought to the final destination, the much anticipated end of Carrie and Big's relationship. Please like, subscribe, and share the series if you've enjoyed this deep dive into the most nerve-wracking struggle couple on television. And thank you to all of my lovely patrons who have been eating up the uncensored version of each installment while waiting for me to get YouTube's approval to post. I appreciate every single last one of you who have helped my channel grow even more. Let's wrap this thing up. We return to the ghastly dregs of the panorama, which sees the girls minus Samantha meeting up for lunch.
Where's the fourth musketeer? Where's Samantha?
She's not with us. Oh. She's in London.
Carrie just sat down, but when she hears that Miranda, this Miranda.
Wife's on the phone.
You told me you were divorced.
I'm really separated.
No, we're really separated.
Hey, I don't need to be lectured about science by a man who's doing crop rotation on his forehead.
Do not follow me. What are you, crazy?
Is picking up her teenaged son's used condoms.
I stepped on a used condom in Brady's room this morning. Wait, I was barefoot at the time.
She desperately wants to go back home to Big.
I stepped on my son's.
Now where is that darn wait person with the check?
We haven't even ordered yet.
Oh, I know, but I want out now.
Bitch, me too!
Carrie returns home with salmon for Big to prepare as they continue with their ritual of listening to records while making dinner, something they began at the start of the panopticon. Somehow, being stuck in the same apartment together for extended periods of time hasn't driven them apart the way it almost did in the second film.
What if I got a place? Just a place that I can go 2 days a week, lie around, watch television, do the shit I want to do that bugs you.
So they are happily married, living their insanely wealthy, child-free lives. At the lunch that Carrie immediately wanted to skip, Charlotte asked Carrie to attend Lily's piano recital, which would have delayed her and Big's planned Hamptons trip.
You haven't RSVP'd yet for Lily's piano recital.
I can't go. Big and I are driving out east on Wednesday.
Can't you drive out Friday? Lily has been practicing for this night every day for years. And this concert, it's a very big deal.
All right, I'll talk to him. I will.
She asks if he wants to attend, but Big hates being seen in public with her.
Hey, can we wait to drive out to the Hamptons till Friday? Charlotte really wants me to go to Lily's recital on Thursday.
Thank you. Do you want to come with me?
Besides, he has other plans.
What are you going to do that night?
I'll be spending the night at home with Allegra.
Oh, her again.
Your Peloton instructor.
She motivates me.
Since he can't get it up anymore, at least not without medical assistance, he cheats on Carrie the only other way he can, with his younger and hotter Peloton fitness instructor. The next day, Carrie heads off to the recital while Big, cosplaying Archie Bunker, takes what will eventually become his final gaze at his long-suffering wife.
Do you notice anything special?
Nope. Bruh. I see the wedding shoes.
Before they head to the Hamptons, Big wants to virtually cheat with Allegra, so he begins his workout while Carrie is watching Lily eat up her recital.
His music touches me ever so. I fear that my tears might stain my petticoat.
But because Lily is the catalyst of misfortune when it comes to these two, the unthinkable happens.
Could you put Carrie on the phone?
I've been calling you for an hour. Why haven't you been answering your phone?
Because I don't know where my phone is!
Lily has been practicing for this night every day for years.
Carrie gets home after Lily's recital and sees her husband slumped over in the shower holding his left arm. Now, the average person would immediately call 911, especially if they know the slumped over party has a history of heart problems, but instead, he and Carrie have a staring contest until it finally registers to her that his health bar is depleting.
Oh,
Carrie does literally everything but call 911, and she waits for him to die, pay back for the 21 years of pain and suffering that she volunteered for.
Honey, help me. Come on, baby.
And just like that, they died.
And just like that, Peloton stock dropped 1 million points. Carrie is obviously beside herself because she made this mysterious, misogynistic, boring weirdo her entire world for the past 20 plus years. At the funeral, we learn he has a brother. Really? Do they have a falling out or something? I thought Big was basically orphaned after his mom passed. And this, ladies and gentlemen, is one of the many perks of being a man. You can mistreat a woman for decades, stand her up at the altar, lie to her on multiple occasions, sexually assault her, and force her into an affair because you're bored in your marriage to a beautiful, much younger woman that you don't deserve, use her as a nurse, and then immediately discard her once you feel better, put in almost zero effort in the marriage once it actually does happen, flirt with Penelope Cruz in front of your wife, ask for 2 days away from her a week because of your extreme incompatibility, and yet still get a moving, sentimental tribute to your existence, which has contributed literally nothing but heartache and pain to those in the closest proximity to you.
He had a wandering eye. Wandered right over to my best friend.
I knew you were having an affair, but not in my house!
Am I the only one that remembers what a f*** he was to her?
And I mean, did she lie? Also, what's the deal with the relationship he had with his secretary? Because she's kind of giving Lil' Kim at Biggie's funeral. Even Carrie acknowledges that their relationship was struggle love personified when she talks to Che after the completion of another dumb podcast in which Bobby Lee jokes
again
about having sex with a minor.
Sure. So I walked down her alley, and the girl at the end of this alley looked like Natalie Portman.
Okay.
From The Professional. Yes, and then we went to this place, the Miami Hotel, and I made love to her.
Oh,
right?
My.
The moon through the curtains shine on her face. She's actually crying. And I felt so bad that I hollered her afterwards.
Wow.
So I can get over with.
She will not stop calling me.
Well, maybe she wants her credit card back.
Nah, she's not old enough to qualify for credit yet.
I'm just gonna be some garbage.
How are you holding up?
It's been a rough few weeks, but just keep reminding myself that at least we were happy. At the end, never been happier.
Yes, apparently the 19 years of struggle were worth the extremely short-lived bliss. Oh, but if you thought it was over, it's not. Big is not done emotionally spanking Carrie, even after he's been ground to dust. Now we have to deal with the will reading. She and Miranda are going through the paperwork when Big's secretary Gloria, the one who sent Carrie the flowers and probably had to remind Big of Carrie's birthday each time it came up.
I just wanted to call and thank you for the flowers. That was very thoughtful of you.
Oh, yeah. Well, you know, my secretary had it on her calendar, so I, you know.
Stumbles upon a pretty damning line in the will.
I hereby make a bequest in the amount of $1 million to... Miranda?
Here it is, $1 million to...
What's all the drama? What's the charity? Natasha?
I knew nothing about it.
In my experience, when people have unfinished business, they tend to throw money at it.
Yep, even in death, Big is still a slippery
piece of garbage.
Okay, so here's this theory that I just came up with. After Carrie told him that she cheated on him by kissing Aiden in Abu Dhabi, Big contacted Natasha, now knowing how it feels to be betrayed, and apologized to her, promising to make it up to her somehow. But of course, she most likely never replied because Natasha was most likely married at this point and completely over his ass. But he definitely intended to get her attention one way or the other, no matter how badly it would have hurt Carrie. So essentially, this was his final get back on Carrie for both not being his ideal woman and for having the nerve to cheat on him. Yep. Carrie begins spiraling again because it's Carrie, and now she wonders if Big was cheating on her and keeping secrets throughout their marriage.
Why is she in there at all? And why did he keep it a secret? He didn't even tell Gloria.
Carrie, you didn't even know that he likes frozen yogurt, that he had a dog.
Did you know Big had a dog named Gogi?
Or whether or not he jerked off.
Do you masturbate? Do you? Well, do you?
Of course he was keeping secrets from you. These intrusive thoughts reignite her disdain for Natasha, the woman who literally didn't do sh** to her.
Why was he still thinking about her after all this time? And what was their unfinished business? I just can't believe it. Big's gone and Natasha's back.
Naturally, Carrie transfers her anger, frustration, and hatred from Big onto Natasha and begins stalking her.
Again?
Again.
The best way for me to just move past this is to look Natasha in the eye and have a grown-up conversation. So I emailed her. Wasn't easy. The first email that I sent bounced back. So I emailed her at 1:40 today and nothing. Nothing. Not a word. Oh, wait a minute. I just found her on Instagram. I'm gonna DM her in case she didn't get my email. Oh my God, she just blocked me on Instagram. Tried to do this the dignified way. She left me no choice. She blocked me on Instagram. I can't reach her through email.
Although this time around should have totally warranted a restraining order, Natasha instead chooses to let Carrie look pathetic.
Natasha's desk, Kathy speaking.
I'd like to speak to Natasha, please. I'm here to see Natasha Mills, Carrie Bradshaw, Preston.
Okay.
She's in a meeting.
Oh, I'll hold. You can just have a seat.
Unfortunately, Natasha is unavailable today. She's in Rome. Have a nice day.
She's not in Rome. She's in that building right there. Oh my God, it's her. It's her.
Oh my God.
Oh,
oh,
my, gosh.
Oh, oh my God.
Oh,
oh
my God.
But then, as usual, in a large city like New York, they somehow run into each other in a Starbucks bathroom, which forces them to have their final confrontation.
Someone's in here. Oh my God. Oh, shit. I need to talk to you.
At a coffee shop? At my job? Where are you gonna hunt me down next, Carrie? In the showers at Equinox?
I never imagined in a million years you'd be all the way up here. This isn't even your neighborhood. Yes, I also know where you live.
What do you want from me? What the f*** do you want from me?
Come on, I mean, what do you want from me?
I'm not really sure anymore. But since you're here, do you think maybe we could just talk?
No, I am not doing this. I've already given you more minutes of my life than you ever deserved.
Carrie's plot armor kicks in after Natasha sees her crispy hand burn from the coffee she spilled on herself and offers her some ice.
Burn looks bad. You should ice it. If this is about the will, I've already told my lawyers I will not accept it. Give it to charity. Why did he leave it to me anyway? I haven't spoken to him since the divorce.
So neither of us knows?
Then, because of said plot armor, gets this totally undeserved comment from the woman who broke her face chasing after her when she caught her husband cheating with her.
I'll never understand why he ever married me when he was always in love with you.
That is not correct.
So in love with her that he stood her up at the altar? Babe, you got the write-up in the Times after the nuptials happened. She had a spread in Vogue, and they had to write in an asterisk blurb that the marriage never even happened. You only had to legally deal with him for barely a year. She spent 2 decades aging herself with his crap. I think it's safe to say that you dodged a bullet if this is what love looks like. Before this, Carrie talked to Miranda and beautifully summed up how she felt about their dumpster fire disastrous union and how even while deceased, Big still managed to remain slippery.
I'm really mad at Big. I almost forgot how I used to feel all those years ago, you know, so nervous and insecure and desperate. You know, like what we had wasn't enough. Like I wasn't enough. And I just hate that after all the good years, this is what I'm left with. He ruined our happy sad ending.
Throughout the rest of the season, despite how angry she was at him for literally placeholdering her their entire relationship, Carrie is convinced that Big is now a ghost.
Well, we should go out again.
Yeah, okay, let's do it.
I'd like to kiss you.
Good to know that his boy radar works even in the afterlife, I guess. Carrie continues grieving the loss of her ex-husband, contemplating what to do with his remains. She decides at the end of the series to wear a gigantic tan-colored ball gown with some cleaning gloves and spread them over the Seine River in Paris.
I don't want you to go through your life, Carrie. My mother doesn't need to meet another girlfriend. I could have just gone down to see you all.
He's not coming. You want your own apartment? Do you notice anything special?
Nope.
Bye, Ashy. In the second season, once Carrie sees that Aiden is now a super rich furniture designer, and because she knows he'll be stupid enough to respond, she emails him to have dinner and they reunite once again.
And just like that.
Here we go again.
And since Big is now dirtying up a river overseas, she can finally see Aiden as a long-term option the way she was never able to with eyebrows in her life. When she talks to Miranda after brunch, she actually says out of her stupid head,
I've been asking myself, was Big a big mistake?
Really? Really? You mean to tell me it only took you 20 plus years and him dying for you to realize that? You mean to tell me you didn't think he was a mistake after he left your ass at the altar? Or after he skipped town without telling you? Or after he married a woman who's the literal complete opposite of you? Or, you know what? I quit. I just do. I quit. Carrie's severe, unresolved daddy issues.
That's some outfit, kid.
How you doing, kid?
Hey, kid.
You're gonna be okay, kid.
What's shaking, kid?
I will miss you, kid.
You look good.
So do you, kid.
Hey, kid.
How you, kid?
I gotta hand it to you, kid.
I got a good feeling about this one, kid.
Well, kid,
you did good, kid. I've seen the town, kid.
Hey, kid.
Kid.
Caused her to suffer for 2 decades, comforted only by Big's money and allegedly good D.
Was it good? It was great.
With an ex can be depressing. If it's bad,
it wouldn't be bad.
When Big colors, he rarely stays inside the lines.
I mean, sometimes I guess it can take a to make you realize that someone wasn't all that while they were alive, but the show is basically all about Carrie attempting to lock this man down as some ultimate validation that she apparently never would have gotten from anyone else, no matter how rich, successful, and stable they were. In conclusion, everything I just said, thanks for suffering through this breakdown with me. It's been a pleasure. Was Big a mistake? Bitch, what do you think?
I Googled you.
And you still showed up for dinner.
What's a murder or two?
They had it coming.